Hi, I'm Colleen Cosmo Murphy, founder of Classic Album Sundays. And today I'm here with a super producer, a pioneer of lovers rock, and also a musician and a songwriter, Dennis Bovell. Dennis, thank you so much for joining me.
Hi, thank you for having me.
it's a pleasure. I've always wanted to speak with you. I've been a fan of your work for many years.
Thank you.
And recently you released this incredible anthology. It's called Dennis Bovell, the DuBMASTER, the Essential Anthology, which has just come out on Trojan Records. And we're going to talk all about it. It's a great, great compilation. Two discs, one disc that's just called The Master, which is all your nice dubbed out versions. Mm-hmm. And the other one, The Artists, when you're working with different singers. And it's a fantastic compilation. So congratulations.
Thank you very much.
So I'd like to talk about your early beginnings. You were born and raised for the first part of your childhood in Barbados with
Correct.
Your grandparents.
Correct.
What was music to you then? What was your musical world like at that point?
My musical world at that time was the Mighty Sparrow.
Yes.
Champion Calypsonian. Mm-hmm. Lord Krishna.
Yeah.
Another champion Calypsonian. And then Ray Charles, Benny King, you know, The Drifters, Sam Cooke.
Oh, yeah.
You know. And I also liked the Scatterlites at that time because a distant relative was the singer of the Scatterlites, a man by the name of Jackie Opel. He was the singer of the Scatterlites in the 60s, and he came from Barbados. So there was interest in what he was doing, a Bajan was doing in Jamaica. Also, two of my uncles had attended University of the West Indies, which there was a site in Jamaica, in Mona campus. And my mother's eldest brother studied as a mathematician and did a PhD in maths there. And one of the younger ones did a degree in physics and chemistry and was part of the invention of the solar panel in later life.
Oh my gosh, that's really interesting.
It's a hard act to follow.
So you had a very scientific family there. How about a musical family? Were your grandparents into music?
Well, both my grandparents were into music. My grandmother played the organ. And my grandfather was a music teacher. And he'd been part of the setting up of a church called the Seventh-day Adventists in an era in Barbados called Mile and a Quarter. Mm-hmm. And he'd been, you know, one of the founder fathers of that church. And he was also the choir master. So he taught the choir, and my mother was like his second in command, you know, his eldest daughter. And so all of his children read music. And the younger brother now, he thought that he would become a calypsonian. He would play what they call secular music, whereas that kind of music was banned in the house. We could only have classical or gospel when the old people were around. We had records like The Drifters, Sand in My Shoes, and that was hidden under the record player, right, so that they didn't find it. And then we'd take them out when they were not at home and play them. But when they were at home, it was classical music or gospel.
Which composers?
I don't know, Tchaikovsky, Bach, Beethoven, Gershwin, all the old classics, right? And then, of course, with the gospel music, too many to mention, mostly coming from the USA, because they would subscribe through the church to gospel music that was readily available in the USA, but not so much in the Caribbean. Right. And so we would have records sent to the house so that we could play them in public so that people could get an insight into gospel music in the USA, of which there's a lot, you know. But then my mum's younger brother decided he was going to play in a band. And so Granddad said, well, you're going to play that kind of music, you better have your own apartment. You know, you're going to do that, not under my roof.
Oh, wow. That's amazing.
So he did, and he left, mm-hmm. and headed to Canada. Before he went to Canada, his group was called Barbara and the Rhythmaires. He was one of the Rhythmaires. Mm-hmm. And he taught me to play the guitar. So he was my guitar teacher, Samuel Headley. And if you see on my album, it's in memory of Samuel Headley, oh. because he was the first man that taught me how to play, Oh, When the Saints Go Marching In. Oh, When the Saints Go Marching. Because that was all we could play in the house.
Right.
You know, so I was learning a lot of gospel songs and gospel choruses so that I could then at church, when it came to the evening section of the church, which was called the Missionary Volunteers, the MVs, right? That was the young section of the church. In the morning, they had the sermon and the preaching and all that. But in the evening, and well, afternoon, after lunch, there would be the young people's meetings. And we'd put programs on, you know, singing, playing, maybe a little bit of drama. And I would often play guitar in that section of the church. And it was quite well received. But then shortly after I started doing that, a letter arrived from London that said, Dennis Bovell is coming to London.
Wow.
On this day, on that aeroplane, with this ticket. And I was like, no, he can't be. And I tried to get our grandmother to switch it to my sister, my younger sister. I said, she should go to London. I should stay here. And Granny was like, no, they want you. You're going. I think it might have been because I'd, at that time, become a little bit feisty.
You were a 12-year-old boy.
Yeah. And when I was due for a thrashing, I quickly said, well, you're not my parents, so you have to get permission from my parents. So you write to London, mm-hmm. tell them what it is that I've done, and if they say thrash him, I'll take a thrashing. But if they say, nah, that's okay, you know, don't touch me. Mm-hmm. And my grandmother was like, oh, you're a big man now, huh? I think you'd be better off in London. So they packed me off.
So there you came to London in 1965, correct?
Correct.
And did your father have a sound system already at that point?
Yes, I came to see, my father was not at all religious. Mm. My mom was. But dad worked for London Transport. So he had lots of friends from all over the Caribbean, all over the world, in fact, Nigeria, mm. Ghana, any person who ever worked on the service, you know, any of the smaller islands in the Caribbean, from Jamaica to Trinidad to Barbados, Grenada, you know, all people that worked in the service. And mom worked for the NHS. So the NHS, the nurses, would often be paired off with London Transport workers. I mean, I've been to any number of weddings of a nurse marrying a bus driver or a nurse marrying a bus conductor, mm-hmm. you know. And so at these kind of functions, Dad would bring out his sound system. It was called Lord Tropical, the Soundmaster. And he had a huge record collection because he would order, by mail order, records from America, records from Jamaica, records from Africa, you know, Nigeria and, mm-hmm. and Ghana. And he had a huge collection because when he was playing his sound system for his friends, it had to be quality sound and quality music. You know, there were people in his dances from all over the world. So he would play merengue, he would play Afrobeat, he would play high life, reggae, soul. I mean, Otis Redding and Wilson Pickett were two big dons about that time, you know. And I would borrow his amplification to plug my guitars in.
Were they valve amplifiers?
Yeah, valve amplifiers. And
10 watts or?
No, 50 watts.
50 watts, wow.
He was a big boy.
That's a big one.
He was a big boy at the time. I mean, now he'd be laughed out of court.
Yeah.
But 50 watts and some huge boxes that he'd built himself. Mm-hmm. I wish I'd had a photograph of me standing by these boxes that were miles taller than me. And I had the opportunity of accompanying Dad for muscle power. You know, lift that box, son, put those over there. And but then I got also the opportunity to hear the music he was playing and see the reaction of the people he was playing to.
Alongside doing a sound system, you're a busy man. You are also playing guitar in a band, or heading off this band, really, Matumbi.
Yes.
Can you tell us about that band as well?
The band was put together because I wanted to play strictly reggae. Bands I'd been in before were pop, bit of R&B, bit of rock, you know, variation of styles. But I wanted to have a band that concentrated only on reggae. Mm. And a lot of people thought, yo, that's professional suicide, because nobody wants an all reggae band back then. And so I didn't care. I was like, we're going to play reggae. And our first gig was at a US and RAF joint base, which we were told, don't play no reggae. And we could play funk and do Otis Redding and all that, you know. Mm. But we were warned not to play reggae because these were a bunch of Americans that were playing to, and they didn't understand that, and they didn't know what reggae was. They probably didn't want to hear it. You know, you got to do Simon Dave.
Yeah.
Hold on, I'm coming, you know. And so we said, okay. And we went on, and the first tune we played in the officer's mess was a Booker T and the MGs tune. You know.
Green Onions.
Yeah.
Melting Pot.
And it was quite well. And then straight after that, we went to play a Prince Buster tune.
Wow.
She was a rough rider. And they were looking, it's like, what's this? And this is music from the Caribbean. It's called reggae. And if you want to know how to dance to it, this is how you dance to it. We went around dancing and then got them into a conga line as we were playing it, and they enjoyed it.
That's amazing. And this is all for people watching. This is, or listening, this is before Bob Marley internationally broke.
Much.
So this is before reggae became a household term, really. Now, your first full-length album from Matumbi came out in 1978, Seven Seals. And on that song was the song Guide Us, which you have another version on this compilation with Johnny Clark.
Mm.
How important was it to you to be able to work with an artist truly from Jamaica?
Mm.
Was that important to you?
It was. In 1973, Johnny Clark had made his debut in the UK. You know, his first concerts in the UK. He had a hit record at the time called Move Out of Babylon. And so when he made his first appearance in the UK, Matumbi was his backing band. Because by then, we had earned the reputation of being able to play reggae exactly like how it was made. And so, starting with Pat Kelly, Johnny Clark, Ken Booth, Derek Morgan, and Iroy. Mm-hmm. We, you know, provided the musical backing for those people. So we were becoming famous as well as being able to play Jamaican reggae the way it was recorded and regurgitate it that way.
So you were touring with these bands when they came over?
Yeah.
Interesting.
So when we toured with Johnny Clark, when we were playing that song Guide Us, he really, really liked it. And I had no idea that he was growing his dreadlocks. And he was all, Jah, Rastafari, and all that. So when we met up again many years later, he said to me, what about that song, Guide Us Jah? I was like, yeah, Johnny. He said, I'd like to do a version of that. So I said, fine. Went into the studio with Drummy Zeb, the drummer from Aswad, and Tony Gadd, who's Aswad's bass player, but he was playing keyboard, I'm playing bass, and John Kapai, a guitar player, who was the author of I'm In Love With The Dreadlocks, which was the first record on the Lovers Rock label. And we cut this version of Guide Us. And Johnny came in the studio and went, yeah, microphone. Bang, nailed it.
Amazing.
But it was just for a dub plate. For my sound system to play, go, hey, no one else can play this. It's not released, so you won't be able to get a copy. Dub plate. And then when BMG called me up and said, we want to put out a record with you. And I'd given them all the tapes that they could choose from. And Lawrence chose that song. I was like, wow. And yeah.
Great. Well, let's have a listen.
They put us in captivity. Many hundreds of years ago, you know, told us that one day we should be free. But when we just don't know, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak.
Have the band Matumbi, and at this time Matumbi really came before Aswad and Steel Pulse, or is it about the same time? It
was Matumbi before. Came before Aswad and Steel Pulse.
How important was it to you to have a you know, a reggae bands that were truly British?
It was good because disputing the myth that reggae could only be properly made in Jamaica, then there were a lot of young British kids saying, no, we're playing reggae, but we're playing it our way, our style. We're not trying to copy that. We're trying to build on that, you know. And Aswad came out as not a group that toured with other people or did, but something doing their own material, you know. And we welcomed that. And also, well, Steel Pulse now, I was invited by a man called Cecil Morris to Birmingham to be a judge on a talent competition. And there were several groups in this talent competition and performers. And the winner of the competition would be treated to a day in the studio with me as a producer, make a record with them. Well, when this group came on and started, Handsworth, Revolution, Handsworth, I dare anyone to say they were not the winners because the crowd was taking their head off. Mm-hmm. And so Steel Pulse were the winners. And the first time in the studio, a date with me. And then I produced Bun Dem and Naya Love was still possible before Island Records had their eye on them and said, Premier, we want to sign you guys too. And I was like, yeah, do it, because it's a big record company, you know. And I knew that Island Records had in their catalog people like Cat Stevens, the Spencer Davis Group, okay? I think Stephen Wolf was in there too.
Traffic.
Hello, you know. And then Jimmy Cliff, Toots and the Maytals, right? Burning Spear. So I was like, you guys are going to a good house, man. Don't worry. Mm. This man, Chris Blackwell, knows how to market reggae and how to bring reggae into the rock sphere. Because he'd had much more success with Cat Stevens than Jimmy Cliff. You know, but he believed that Jimmy Cliff was going to be a hit, and he did that, and he did the film Harder They Come and all that, you know. He also believed that Aswad were, you know, probably going to be... And he didn't stop until they got a number one in the British charts, you know, Don't Turn Around. Steel Pulse, however, never made it into the British charts, but they jumped labels and went with a Danish label. And to this day, they're the only British band to have won a Grammy, you know, in the Grammys.
So British reggae did very well.
Yes. And Maxi Priest now is the only British reggae singer to have topped the charts in the US.
Oh, wow.
I mean, I saw him on Oprah.
Yeah.
I was like, Maxi!
That's amazing. It's amazing that, you know, this music, which came from a... born on a very small island.
Yeah.
And all these different myriad of forms of Jamaican music, of course, is all different sounds. The kind of how it's, you know, penetrated every single country
in the
around
world.
The and around the globe. It's really, really quite incredible.
Because it's infectious.
It is. It's infectious. It's great to dance to. It's that's hooky, and there's, you know, there's memorable melodies.
Yeah,
I think. And also many covers, too, of course. Yes. I think about all the American R&B songs. And that brings me, actually, to the next song I wanted to talk with you about, because it's a cover. But it's a jazz cover. Mm. On here, you have a group. You call yourselves the Young Lions. I'm not sure if it's you with some of the band members of Machoombi.
Yes, it's Lloyd Donaldson, we call Ja Bunny. He's on drums. And then I'm on the bass. And the keyboard was... Nick Straker.
Oh, and I know Nick Straker, a little bit of jazz.
Correct. Well, Nick Straker and I were founder members of Matumbi.
Yeah.
He was the keyboard player of Matumbi when we started.
Wow.
And so, and John Kapai on guitar, and Steve Gregory, saxophonist, who played that famous saxophone intro on George Michael's Careless Whisper. And he was
really
he played with everybody: Dusty Springfield, Van Morrison, Georgie Fame, Boney M.
Wow,
as a sax player, you know. And he was my neighbor. So
my goodness, so he's in the Young Lions.
Yes, Steve Gregory was a saxophone player.
Now, wow! And how did you get gigs? Did you get gigs in London as the Young
Lions?
We
didn't do any gigs as the Young Lions. What had happened was that a friend, rest in peace, Jerry McCabe, who was the owner of the Astoria. And first of all, before that, he owned a club in Peckham called Mr. B's. And at this club, you could see artists like Curtis Mayfield, you know, Bloodstone, and a lot of American artists. And so we went up to him one day and said, you're like, you should have some reggae in this club. He's going, oh, yeah. He's going, yeah, we've got a reggae band. And in fact, if you don't give us a gig, we could disrupt services for you. And he laughed, because this was a man who'd been Mr. Ireland. And his biceps were bigger than my throat, you know.
Wow. And that took a lot of guts for you to say that.
Yeah. But we wanted a gig there.
Mm-hmm.
And there'd been no reggae in that club, right, until Matumbi did a reggae gig there. And he said, ha, I'll let you play, but if you play crap, I'm going to throw the first bottle. Right?
So now that's a threat.
We rose to the challenge, and we went there, and brought the house down with reggae. And then Amazing. As a result of that, we were gigging in that club like every 8 weeks or something. You know, we'd become the group that most played in that club, reggae.
And did you play this cover that you did of Take Five at that place?
No, because Take Five came much later in the 70s, around about 78, 79, when Jerry said, I want to do three songs with you. And I was like, what are they? The first one was Take Five. The second one was Tom Hark. And then the third one was Gonna Get Along Without You Now with Viola Wills. Mm-hmm. And so we did all three of them. And at that point, he was running, or he owned a club called the Whiskey A Go-Go, which became the WAG.
Very
the WAG, W-A-G, Whiskey A Go-Go.
Yeah, and, very important club in London nightlife history.
Absolutely. And the studio, Gerrard Street, Gooseberry, was 300 or 400 meters away from the club. So while we were working in the studio, he would go, do you need some wine down there? Do you need some drink? Yeah, send us. And at that time, the fad was Blue Nun.
Yeah.
Right? Liebfraumilch. Right? And we would drink that. He would put it in the freezer till it became like a slush puppy.
Mm-hmm.
So we were slushing Liebfraumilch, right?
Oh, Blue Nun. Oh, gosh.
And getting on with the music.
That's so funny. My goodness. Well, let's have a listen. I think this cover of Take Five is brilliant. I mean, Take Five is one of the most famous jazz songs there is, from one of the most famous jazz albums, Time Out. And it's a great version. Is there anything else you'd like to say about it before we have a listen?
Well, I'd like to thank all the people who helped me put that together, because I think I chose the right crew who could play that. I mean, when you listen to the drums, right, he was out there for a reggae drummer, but he'd been a student of Lloyd Nibbs. And Lloyd Nibbs is the drummer, the original drummer from the Scatterlights.
Oh, wow.
So once speaking to Lloyd Nibbs one time, and I, you know, mentioned Bunny's name, and I mentioned Carlton Barrett, the drummer of the Wailers.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, yeah, I taught both of them. So I kind of had the feeling, because they've both got a bit of his style, you know, and he massive drummer.
Yeah.
You know.
Let's have a listen. Producer, who were you looking up to? Who are the other producers that you really admired? And I'm not even talking just strictly reggae as well, just in general, who were some of the producers that you really admired?
I'd say Norman Whitfield.
That's my favorite. I was hoping you were going to say that.
Yeah, Norman Whitfield. And on the reggae side, Lloyd Chalmers.
Lloyd Chalmers. Mm-hmm.
Those were my two champion producers. Also, Willie Mitchell, the man who produced Al Green, is also one of my favorite producers. And then, as a producer, I think Jimi Hendrix. Mm. I think there were other people credited with the production, but what I can gather of Jimi Hendrix's temperament, nobody could produce Jimi Hendrix.
He produced Electric Ladyland. Eddie Kramer was just engineering.
Yeah. Well, Eddie Kramer was a great mechanical engineer. Mm. He made gadgets for Hendrix to plug into, and that was commendable.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. But nobody could tell Hendrix what to do or what to play when.
The first two albums, but people did tell him, I think, what to do, and then he just took more control of himself and he built his own studio, like you did.
Yeah.
Because that's what you have to do if you want to be in control.
That's true.
You worked at Gooseberry Studios in Chinatown as an engineer.
Yes.
And then you went to Dip Studios.
It's called Eve Studios.
In Broccoli, okay.
Yeah. Now, Dennis Harris, rest in peace, he had been involved with Susan Cadogan. Hurts So Good. Mm. And that record had gone up the charts. It was produced by Lee Perry. And it had gone up the charts. And Dennis was involved with it. And so, on the strength of that, he sold his mini mart, because he was a grocer. He sold his mini mart and built a recording studio. And one day said to me, "Here's the keys. You're the engineer." He didn't ask me. He told me. He was true Jamaican.
Yeah.
You're going to be the engineer, right? And I tell you what, you see that other key? If you get too tired and can't go home, there's a room upstairs where you can go and kip.
Oh, wow.
But you have to make me at least an album every month.
Wow.
So I hit on the idea of calling myself and other players that were around me the Fourth Street Orchestra.
Mm.
And Fourth Street, because I don't think there are any Fourth Streets in England, but it was definitely leaning to America and leaning to Jamaica, where they got First Street, Second Street, Third Street, Fourth Street. So in my quest for disguising what the music, where the music was and who played, I made these tunes. And then when we released the first album, Ahu Se Gode, which is coming out on Trojan soon, we didn't give any credit to anybody or any thanks to anybody. It came out on a white label in a white sleeve.
I was looking on Discogs at that today, at that debut album. It came out in 1976, I believe, around there. I was like, who? It just says produced by Dennis Bovell. I couldn't figure out anything else about the artist, and it did make me think of New York as well.
Well, the whole idea was that it would subside the prejudice that reggae could not be made in the UK, not to sound of any quality. So I did that, and then did more albums than under the Fourth Street Orchestra. But what happened was that there was a journalist called Snoopy, and he was a real Snoopy Snoop. He published a piece in his Black Echoes, and said, "Listen up, y'all. You see that Fourth Street Orchestra album? That ain't nobody in Jamaica. That's Matumbi from right here in the UK." And the rest of the band was like, you couldn't keep your mouth shut, could you?
Yeah.
You had to go and tell somebody. I was like, I didn't tell nobody. I didn't tell him. So I said to him, "Snoops, how did you know?" And he pointed out that there was one song on the album where there was the distinctive vocals of the singer from Matumbi. So you thought, ah, that's Matumbi's singer. He ain't never been to Jamaica, so it must have been made in London. And he surmised that from hearing that one voice on the first album. So after that, it was like, yeah, it's us.
So there was a real issue at that time then, if maybe a credibility issue, that if you came out of Britain, you weren't as credible as if
you had
come out of Jamaica.
Correct.
Right.
And also in the Eve Studios era, we availed ourselves of something called a dinking machine. Now, records that were pressed in the UK had a tiny little hole in the middle. But records that were pressed outside of the UK, like America or Jamaica or anywhere, they had a huge hole in the middle. And you knew when you saw that big hole, that was an import. So I got this machine that could cut a big hole in my 7 inches and put them out there. And everyone was thinking it was an import.
That's interesting. I didn't realize that. So you had to use the 45 adapter, as we
say in America.
Right, I got you. I mean, you were doing so many different things. Let's have a listen to the 4th Street Orchestra. I picked out the song Raindrops. Could you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, Raindrops is... there's two different versions of Raindrops. There was one version that I made solo by myself. And there's another version that I made with the group. Mm-hmm. So I think the version that's on there says the 4th Street Orchestra, but I think it was actually the dub band.
I think there's the dub and the one with the band. I think there's both on here.
Well, now the dub one is called Eye Water. Mm-hmm. And that is the solo dub version of the one I made on my own when I was attempting to prove that I could be a musician that played the drums and played the bass and the guitar and the keyboard and did the singing as well. One-man mm-hmm. band.
Wow. Well, let's have a listen. So you worked at Gooseberry Studios, then Eve Studios, but then you eventually opened your own, Studio 80. Yeah. Can you tell us how that came about?
Well, I'd become bored with only using downtime in the studio, because I was working as an engineer to get the money to pay for my own use of the studio. And I thought, I should open my own studio. So just before that, I was asked to be the musical director of a film called Babylon. Mm-hmm. And out of the proceeds of that film, I had enough money to open my own studio. So I decided, yeah, I'm going to open my studio. And before the studio was open, I had a phone call from someone in Japan saying that Ryuichi Sakamoto wanted to come over to London and work in my studio. And I said, well, it's not fully operational yet. And the voice came back and said, I want to use it before you do. I thought, that's a strange request. And I knew about Ryuichi Sakamoto, having been a fan of YMO. Mm. And so faced with that man coming to my studio to record, I was like, mate, I don't have to use my studio. You could use my studio first, because I know whatever we do is going to be internationally, you know.
Yeah, internationally recognized. It was B2 yeah. Unit, that
that's
that album.
That was his first solo album mm-hmm. after YMO. And we did a track called Riot in Lagos, and it was phenomenal. It was astro.
I mean, DJs in America play that song.
Yeah.
I believe Larry Levan played it at the Paradise Garage. It's one of those kind of cult underground dance hits. Quirky. Yeah.
Tim Westwood busted it over here.
Really?
Tune. He was like, oh, Tim Westwood played a tune that he was involved in again. Yeah? Which one was it? Riot in Lagos. I'll go, yeah.
Well, speaking about Lagos, you had another musician who recorded there as well. Hmm. Fela Kuti.
Fela Anikulapo Kuti.
Yes.
And do you know what Anikulapo means?
What does it mean?
He who hath death in his quiver. So he's got death in his pocket. That's when he's like, he ain't dying for now.
He ain't dying.
You know, and he came over originally to get some royalties out of EMI. Mm. And he brought about 20 people with him, his entourage. And he was going to Holland, to Amsterdam, to record a live album. And so the people at EMI said, Dennis, fella's going to Amsterdam to record in the Paradiso, and we want you to supervise the recording. I went to Amsterdam with fella and the band, set up in the Paradiso to record this album, Live in Amsterdam, Movement of the People. We're recording in the gig, and the lighting engineer was a bit of a pain because there were certain lamps that created a buzz, like that. And I was trying to say to him, man, just put the lights all on. He's going, oh, this is my job, man. That's why. And he was going, but his friends was laughing whenever the, and, oh, there we go now, all over my recording. In fact, Bob Curry from Capital America wanted to punch his lights out.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
He said, no, Bob, you don't want to go to jail in Amsterdam. Right? So, when we got back to London to mix the record, I was able to filter out most of these noises, except for the bass channel. The buzz on the bass channel was awful all the way through. Mm-hmm. Fella was, I can only describe him as being mad. And then, because not being able to mix that, the whole project was a waste of energy. So I said, don't worry, I'll replace that bass line for you. He went, you play the bass? Because then he'd only known of me as a sound engineer and recording and all that. He didn't know that I was a musician as well. So I plugged in the bass and replayed the bass line. Saved the day. The record company saw fit to put engineer, live engineer, Dennis Bovell, and then in the musical credits, bass, Dennis Bovell. A lot of people were going, how did you do that? I mean, were you playing bass from the console in the gig, or how did you do it? So I was going, no, that bass was an overdub, because by the time we were putting that bass on, the whole band had gone back to Nigeria already.
You know? Wow, yeah.
So fella was pissed. But it not being able to do it without that bass. So when I replayed the bass, he was like, from there on, I couldn't get away from him. Mm. You know, he wanted me everywhere he was. Dennis has got, where's Dennis?
Well, that's a real compliment, isn't
yeah.
it?
Yeah, it was at that point where my dad said, you're working with reputable people now.
And he called Fela reputable?
Yeah.
Just joking.
Yeah, because that, for him, that was like serious.
Well, he is serious. I mean,
serious music.
Hugely serious music.
Yeah.
I was saying that in jest just because of his antics, really.
Oh, yeah.
He had quite a few antics.
We know what he went up to.
But an incredible studio. Now, I want to kind of rewind a little bit now. It's talked about the... your involvement and pioneering of Lover's Rock and working with all these incredible female vocalists as well. So there was a song that you worked on by Louisa Marx, produced by Sir Coxon, called Caught You in a Lie. It came out in 1975, I believe.
Around there, yeah.
How you worked on that track too. Can you tell me a little bit about that?
Well, Lloyd had the idea to do a reggae version of that song, which is originally an R&B song by Robert Parker from the US. And he used to sign on his sound system with that tune. When Neville Coxon set up his sound, the first tune you would hear would be that. Caught You in a Lie, R&B version. So he wanted to do a reggae version. He came to see me, and I agreed, and we went into the studio, whereupon I played the bass, I played the guitar, keyboard, and the drummer was... Uton Jones from Matumbi. And Robbie Shakespeare was in the studio at the point where I'm laying a keyboard, and it's a Moog synthesizer. Now, this synthesizer was common in Yes and Genesis, people like that, right? Hardcore.
Prog kind of bands.
Prog, yeah. And I was saying to Robbie Shakespeare, I said, Robbie, you ain't never seen one of these in Jamaica. You know, and you could tune the things. And he was going, yeah, sort of weird. And then whilst playing the intro of the song, I went, hear this. And Lloyd Coxon said, did you record that? I said, yeah. He goes, don't rub it out. That sounds like a great intro for the song. And on came Louisa, do the vocals.
And that was a really important song. It was a seminal song for Lover's Rock. Yeah,
well,
for
that was
reggae,
because
Lover's Rock.
That was because Lloyd Coxon was playing it on his sound system. And Coxon's sound had... a statement that they would make. We don't play English record. We only play strictly dub from Jamaica, our pre-release. And there he was playing that on his sound system. So people believed that it was a non-English recording. And because Coxon was playing it, it became very popular. And other sound systems wanted a copy. And I think it was doing the sound system rounds for at least 2 years before Safari released it.
Mm-hmm. Now, you have a special dub version that you've done, I believe, just this year, correct?
It looks like it's relatively recent,
a couple of years ago.
The thing is that this version, I would sing it on my live shows to remember Louisa and that song. So I made a version where it was leaning more to the ska, you know, side. And then I reclaimed it as a male song, because a man singing the song, and then Louisa, we had to doctor the lyrics so it was coming from a woman. And then I just reclaimed it and said, no, started to sing the song.
Well, that's great. Well, let's have a listen to that.
Found out that he was
found out that
Say that, Louisa Marks, would you say it's safe to say that's kind of the start of Lover's Rock, would you say?
Yes, yeah. Because it was the start of the English reggae being recognized and an English female singer who had not been heard of before. That was her debut record. Mm-hmm. So all those things culminated, right, to appreciation of someone in England singing a reggae song with a different kind of slant on the tune, a slant that we called Lover's Rock.
Yeah. And Lover's Rock was also a song by Augustus Pablo.
Yes, Augustus Pablo had a fantastic single out. I think it was produced by Lenny Chin on the Santic record label. And it's called Lover's Rock. And I liked those two words, the way how they hung together. So once in a production meeting with Dennis Harris, I suggested that the new thing on the street was Lover's Rock. And he went, oh, okay. And took his pen out and drew a heart with a Cupid thing going for it. And that's the label. And the first song on that label was a song written by my friend John Kopai for Brown Sugar. I'm in love with the dreadlocks.
We should say who Brown Sugar is, because there's a lot of famous people in Brown Sugar.
Yes, Brown Sugar consisted of Pauline Catlin, then Coffee, the singer, and Karen Wheeler. And Karen Wheeler became, or still is, the singer of Soul to Soul. I mean, back to life, back to reality.
So these women, these British women, the children of Windrush, really, they were coming into their own, and you were really helping them along the way here, because this was music that was sung by women, and I think probably mainly, I hate to use the word consumed with music, but mainly championed by female audiences, if I'm correct. Mm. I would assume that it was mainly a female audience that you were getting with these songs.
Yeah, and the female audience was delighted, in my opinion, that there was someone on the stage that they could relate to singing songs about their life or about, where they probably had been or what had happened to them, you know. And I had noticed that reggae was lacking female, input, okay? So I decided that what we should have is the new Diana Ross or the new Aretha Franklin in reggae, of course. The new Gladys Knight in reggae, because America had so many powerful female singers that were recognized, and Britain had nearly none. So through the reggae idiom, I decided to bring all these people that were great singers and deserved a chance to portray their talent. And that was how I went about it. The first, my first, not guinea pig, but my first experiment was with a singer called Marie Pierre. Mm-hmm. Now, we'd been recording together because she's family. And in fact, as far back as the school studio, I had dressed her up in boy's uniform, put her hair back and all that, and taken her into the school so we could record in the school's recording studio. Oh, wow. And that song is called Cry, and that's on the anthology. But at that point, her name was Angelique. It was later on that she decided to become Marie Pierre, because her real name is Marilyn Percy. So Marie Pierre. Oh. And we did very well.
You also produced her debut album, Love Affair, which came out on Records in 1979.
Right. Yeah, I did.
On this compilation, you have a song that you did with her called Our Tune.
Yes.
Can you tell us about that?
Our Tune is coming from my solo album, Brain Damage. The song is about, you know, when you say, oh, they're playing our song. Mm-hmm. So we dance. They're playing our tune. So I wrote a tune called Our Tune, you know, and it started off, come on, babe, let's take a chance, rock with me, just one more dance, you know. And I enlisted the services of trombone player Henry Matic, right, we call him Buttons, to play trombone and give me a solo on that. And when Marie heard my verses, she was like, I should be singing that song. So I reconstructed it for her to sing. And then I hadn't released it. Well, I had, kind of, but not on a general scale. I had released it on a small label called PC. And Lawrence heard it. I said, listen to that. I haven't, you know, it's been out on PC, but I haven't...
I should say Lawrence works for Trojan Records. He's a real archivist, and he knows every Trojan record ever made and not made.
Lawrence Kane Honeysett.
Yeah.
The man is an encyclopedia.
He is. Yeah.
Right? And I sent the tune to him. Listen to this. He went, I checked that on Discogs. They're selling it for £400.
Well, now you can get it on this compilation.
Yeah. So we thought, we'll thwart that.
Yeah. Well, let's have a listen to that. Fantastic. After Marie Pierre, you also worked with Janet Kay, Silly Games. Now, this has to be the defining moment for Lover's Rock. This was a massive hit.
It's become quite an anthem.
Yeah. Mm. Was it an anthem when it came out as well?
Yes. Mm-hmm. The thing was that I was trying to dethrone Sly Dunbar as the greatest reggae drummer ever. So I'd come up with this pattern where on the hi-hat, I'm doing like a high life calypso, like that. And then on the snare, I'm dropping it in Afrobeat style. And then on the kick drum, I'm doing it disco style, four to the floor. Boop, boop, So the combination of those three elements made up that drum pattern. But then I had to find someone who could play it, because I could play it for 20, 30 seconds, but for a whole 4 minutes. So I got Drummy Zeb from Aswad, you know, and I said, Drummy, listen to this pattern. And I played it, he went, incredible. I should be playing that. I went, there you go. And then he sat on that drum kit and made it his own.
Wow.
So then it came to recording the song. He's in the drum booth. I'm in the control room, doubling as bass player and recording engineer. And the only way he can know the song is by me telling him the different movements of the bass line that kind of marked the chorus and the verse. I was going, well, when the bass is playing slowly, which is do 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 dum, do 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 dum, leisure, do 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 dum, that's the verse. And then when it's going dum do 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 do, like a racing heartbeat, that's when she's going.
How she hits those notes, those mini Ripperton notes.
The thing was that I'd seen Ella Fitzgerald on an advert for Memorex, where she sang a note that shattered a glass on the table.
Oh, wow.
And I thought, it'd be great if I could get a note like that in a song. And so I constructed this song, and it was going to be chorus, verse, half bridge, kind of not your regular two chord reggae tune. But I had written it like a pop song and then put the reggae beat inside, you know, which was the same thing that a lot of these reggae covers were made of.
Mm-hmm.
But only it wasn't a cover, it was a reinterpretation of those chord patterns. And then I needed to do my famous intro, because I was known as the intro king. And what it was, that we did a lot of sessions for a lot of other producers, me and my friends. And then I'd be looked upon to do an intro for the song that changed it, because they'd seen me change the intro to Caught You in a Lie. And so everyone wanted to come with an original intro. So I was thinking hard, why am I going to intro this tune? And in the studio was a new synthesizer called the SH-2000 by Roland. And it was fresh on the market. Not only was I using it, but Gary Newman was using it too in the same studio. So I hit upon this string sound thing that went beep, 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 boop, boop. I thought, yeah, it reminded me of being in Barbados when cable radio ceased. Because in Barbados in the early days, there was a company called Ready Fusion, and it was cable radio.
Okay.
All they would do is bring the wire and a loudspeaker, and you could put the volume up or down, but you couldn't change the station.
Yeah.
And when they did away with that and had the first FM broadcast, that dip, 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 reminded me of the first song that I'd heard on that FM broadcast. It just took me back there.
Do you remember what that song was?
No. Wow. I don't remember what the song was, but it was an orchestra piece.
Mm-hmm.
And so I made up my orchestra thing to go with City Games before she started singing, I've been wanting you.
I mean, this song is an anthem. And would you say this is really a defining moment in terms of, see what we can do with British reggae? This is, we have made our own thing now.
And we have made it into the charts.
Yeah.
Because until then, there'd been a few reggae tunes in the charts. Not a lot, but enough to the public to understand that there was this genre, reggae. And so when Silly Games came, it was the opening of a new genre, Lovers Rock. you know, and the people took to the title of the thing and the song, and then it was suddenly in the charts. I mean, Janet cannot do a show without singing that song.
And I've seen her sing it, and she gets the audience to try to sing it with her, and everyone's trying to sing the high notes. It's a competition. It's really good.
She once told me, "I wish I'd never met you." I mean, why? She goes, "Do you know what it's like to sing for 2 hours a show and then have to do that tune at the end of it, right? When my voice is..."
Oh my gosh, she still sounds great. I do love all the kind of socially conscious the thread that runs through your work, and especially you did this song with Iroy. It's Get Up Stand Up, not a cover of Bob Marley.
It's just called Get Up Stand Up.
It's just called Get Up Stand Up. That's featured on this anthology. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, Iroy arrived from Jamaica with a brand new album. He was signed to Virgin, and they turned it down. It's like, nah, not good enough for you. What you want to do is go in the studio with Dennis Bovell and do a new album. It's like, they knocked back that Jamaican thing and they want me to do something. That was an honor, you know. And Ira went, yeah, all right, cool. We went into the studio and goes, Dennis, you build a rhythm solder. And one of the rhythms I built was that is now called Get Up, Stand Up. And when he heard it, he was like, hey, I like that. And when the record company heard it, they went, that's much better. And there he was working with an English producer in an English band in an English studio, right? Tearing to threads that reggae could not be made in the UK.
Wow. So there you go. That must make you feel so great.
Yeah, especially when it resonated and I had, the mouth on there, Iroy. Now, a lot of people would have thought, Iroy, he must have made that in Jamaica. Wrong.
And did it do well in Jamaica?
I don't think so. Because the album never really made anything. Mm-hmm. But that track, I had revoiced it with him using different lyric to the lyric that we recorded for the for the Virgin record. Mm-hmm. And I'd stashed it in the back somewhere. I was like, yeah, I'll get to that later. It was a dub plate to play on the sound system. And then whilst I was mixing songs for this production, suddenly the tape ran onto that song. And I was like, wow, that song should be on this album. So I was working at the time with Joe Ariwa. was the son of the Mad Professor Mad Professor studio in Arriva Studios. And Joe was my little nephew, you know. And we pulled the track up and gave it a digital working.
Mm-hmm. Fantastic.
Yeah.
Let's have a listen.
Now I've been sitting and I've been looking at the world and the radical changes lately. And I've been saying to myself, the leaders of the world, don't stop studying war and demand. This yellow thing ain't gonna go far. I'm gonna shout it out loud and clear so the world can hear. So get up, I say stand up, I say get up. Now find out we know why I'm no blue down. Get up, I say stand up, I say get up. I say beat down but y'all kill it all. I'm out. Get up, I say stand up, I say get up. I say can't we know.
So now all of a sudden you are getting more validation as an English producer of Jamaican-based music, because I would say Lovers Rock is a British form, but obviously it's based on Jamaican music as well.
Yeah, it's standing on the shoulders of the Jamaican reggae giants.
So then all of a sudden now you're starting to work with Jamaican artists like Iroy, but also Delroy Wilson. How did that come about?
Well, I've always been a huge Delroy Wilson fan. Mm. And whilst in my studio one night, in comes Lloydie Coxon again with Delroy Wilson. And I have this tune called Hooked on You. And I'm thinking, that fits Delroy's voice, man. So I play it to him and go, what do you think? He goes, yeah, I'll sing that. Where's the microphone? And then suddenly, goose pimples.
I bet.
Delroy Wilson singing my tune, you know. And sadly, shortly after that, he passed away. Mm-hmm. So I was reluctant to release the record until Lawrence Gain Honeysett said, hey, I know you did that tune. I want it for this compilation. I was going, take it, man. Because having made all of that music, I'm very close to each song. Because if someone was to turn up and say, all right, you're a father of six, we've got to whittle you down to three, which three of your children will you get rid of? I'm like, I love them all.
Yeah.
It's the same thing with my music. I love them all. There's a story behind doing each one of those tunes that some of the stories, people won't believe that it's true. You know, like, Lloydie Coxon walking into the studio with Delroy Wilson and me getting him to sing that tune right there and then, it was like, whoa. That showed that the tune had legs. Because he learned it in incredible speed, mm-hmm. you know, and then I hadn't followed through with it.
But it also showed that Jamaicans musicians were starting to have more respect.
Yeah.
For British British producers and musicians as well.
Yeah.
So let's have a listen to that moment that you capture with Delroy Wilson in the studio, Hooked on You.
Yeah.
I'm hooked on you, yeah. tell you, baby, this fool being in love with you. Yeah. Girl, don't you know?
Talking with you earlier about Black Uhuru, Dub Factor, which our friend Paul Groucho Michael, you know, took some of Black Uhuru's other material.
Groucho is amazing. My brethren.
He's incredible producer.
Yeah.
And you did Y and Dub. Are there any other albums that you could think of that you would love just to do a dub version of? Any album in the world.
There is Paul McCartney's first album. There's a song on there called Temporary Secretary.
Oh, I know that one. That's such a good one.
That was the beginning of loops on synthesizers, because they went for the whole song. In fact, when I played that to my children, they would go mental when they heard that song. Hey, Mr. Marx, would you send for me? Right? They would go mental on that. Also, Superstition, Stevie Wonder.
Oh, yeah.
I'd like to get my hands on that and dub it up.
That would be amazing.
Yeah.
That would be amazing. Well, this is a great anthology. Congratulations on it. The DuBMASTER, the Essential Anthology.
Thank you.
I'd like you to choose the last song for us to play before we go. Which song would you like us to play?
I'd like to play a song called Blood Agar Run. Reason being that this song was written the day after I'd seen Alex Haley's Roots, right? And I was like, wow, that all happened. And it was an opening of my eyes to the realization of what it was. So using that Enoch Powell statement, Rivers of Blood, I went, yeah, blood I go run. Because for all the wrong that's been done, you know, only blood can pay for it, kind of. So I started off, you came and you took I away from my father's land in Africa, you know. And it was, makes no difference if you change my name, cause in my heart I'll remain the same. Blood I go run in a Babylon. Blood I go run. And also, it was a case of me being the band instrumentalist, me playing all the instruments and doing all the singing. It was a one-man record.
Wow. Well, thank you so much, Dennis. It has been a true joy to sit here and talk about your career and this record. I've wanted to speak with you for a while. Dream come true.
Okay.
Thank you
too.
So much.
All
and
right.
Thanks to all of you for listening and to all of you for watching.
Yep. Keep on watching and listening.
Run, run, run. I away from my
man's land, Africa.